When we started this event 12 years ago, our mission was to provide an annual event that would celebrate the achievements of African Americans and the role that we have played in American history, as well as the contributions we made to world history. We firmly believe that the more one knows about their history and culture, the greater the effect on their self-esteem and their racial pride. Each year, as part of the showcase, we present what we call Conversations with Greatness. This consists of a presentation by esteemed, undeniable history makers. And this year, we've been blessed to have three such persons that definitely qualify for that and actually carry that honor with, I mean, just the highest regard. Yesterday, we had Dr. John Carlos speak. We also had Dr. Bobby Seale speak, and today we're truly blessed to have Dr. Molefi, Asante, and just to, who just in case anyone didn't know, he is the most published African-American author alive. So I think that deserves a round of applause. Dr. Asante will be speaking about his new book, Lynching Barack Obama, and I think it's important, afterwards he'll be doing a book signing, and I think it's important for us to take advantage of opportunities like this to hear firsthand from an author about what they wrote as opposed to a review. We all know that if we start on this end right here and say one thing, by the time it gets to that row, it's totally different. So I think, well, everyone can appreciate the fact that we can get it firsthand right here. And we know as the first black president of the United States, Barack Obama met immediate resistance from a white majority that voted for his opponent in 2008. Lynching Barack Obama addresses the white right wing that have used various techniques to string up presidential objectives. So without any further ado, I'd like to bring to the stage our own Dr. Molefi Asante.
Barigani. Hotep. Brothers and sisters, let me just tell you, I am delighted to be here, and I always say to Brother L that what he has done for us and what he's doing for us in this community is remarkable, it's unique, it is a sacrifice, it is hard work, I know that, and yet he continues, and he needs all of our support, and we're just really happy that he sees the need for this kind of exposition of the greatness of the African people. There are no people who have come as far as we have come against such great odds and with such success that I can think of in the history of the world. We don't even realize who we are. And I was just saying to my wife earlier that listening to and seeing the Universal Drum and Dance Ensemble made me realize again and again the genius of the African people in this land and throughout the world. There has to be something in us that is problematic if we do not appreciate that we even look best in our own clothes. Brother Nazir was elegant when he was playing the cora. I just was moved to get up and take a picture of the elegance of Africa there before us. This, we always look best in our own clothes. We look best when we wear our own names. We are people who have been basically dislocated from our cultural center, from our historical center and our historical narrative. So I'm just delighted to be here to talk about a number of things. I'm going to start with the Obama book, but I have actually three books that I have just published in the last 5 months or 6 months. And Lynching Barack Obama, How White People Tried to String Up the President, is the one that Ev was talking about. And this book, there's a very interesting situation that in 2008, when Barack Obama was running for the presidency the first time, a white conservative writer wrote an article in which he says that Barack Obama was basically influenced by Molefi, Asante. He wrote an article in a conservative magazine, and I have all this information in the book, where he said that when he was writing his book about dreams of my father, that in that book there is a passage which Obama attributes to Asante Moran. But he says that the Asante Moran in the book is really Molefi Asante. This is what the white conservative said. And what does Asante Moran say? Asante Moran in Chicago, at a public school in Chicago, tells Barack Obama that the American educational system was not designed for black people. And I said to myself, when I read that, it sounds like me. Because I don't believe it has ever was designed for us. And if it were designed for us, then our children would be healthy. But it's not designed for black people. And everything that we do to try to correct it, it is trying to make it so it responds. Can you imagine what would happen if every day our children heard the drums that we just heard here? You're talking about discipline? You're talking about giving people a sense of focus? Did you see the young brother? He must have been no more than three. Did you see him?
Yeah.
With your own eyes you saw it. But do you know what you saw? How did Brother Rob Dickerson get a three-year-old to stand on stage and play that long? It's culture. You don't have culture, you have nothing. You don't even know what to expect of people who don't have culture. You know, if I knew that you had culture, it's predictable what you would do. It's predictable how you would act. But without culture, or with an alien culture, and that's worse. You come with an alien culture, and I don't understand that. And that's what happens a lot of times in our community. But let me just talk about the book first, and then I will get into a real conversation with you. But Lynching Barack Obama is that I tried to record all the times, and I missed one very important one, that the white legislators have tried to prevent him from having any success in his presidency. They tried everything, and let me be open here and transparent about it. I understand some of the objections and some of the commentaries that have been made by my brothers and sisters about Barack Obama. I've had some myself, but mine, I hope, have always been principled. I think, for example, that Barack Obama should have released the sanctions on Zimbabwe. I believe that. I sincerely believe that. I believe that Barack Obama should not have taken the advice of his advisors to bomb Libya. I believe that. That's just my, that's the way I believe. I believe. The things that, I don't think that he should have encourage the picking up of Mexican immigrant people and sending them back to Mexico. All those things I can't approve. I don't like that. Yet, despite that, he is the greatest president that I have known in my lifetime. None of us is perfect, and not only that, no white person ever came close to it. You name it. Reagan? Come on. Clinton? They have not come close to it, and nobody has had the cool that he has. When they have attacked him, when his own people have attacked him, because they didn't understand. Why didn't we understand? We didn't understand the political system of this country. A president is not a dictator. And he said that very early on. If I were a dictator, I could just change things the way I want them. But I'm not a dictator. If I get ready to do something, I have to let the Congress know. The Congress has to debate it. And if the Congress is controlled by Republicans, who hate the fact that there's a black president, it's going to be hard for me to get done what I need to do. That's the reality. That's how you lynch a black president. You say, okay, as they said, all right, you're the president, but we ain't going to let you do anything. That's what they from the beginning. They disrespected him from the beginning. You a liar, they said. And the last thing, the thing that I didn't catch was when Scalia died. Supreme Court Justice Scalia died. And before the man was buried, they got on the news and said, Barack Obama better not suggest anybody to replace him because we're not going to vote on him. We're not even going to discuss it. The man hadn't even been buried. But that was their reaction to Barack Obama. This reaction is the same kind of reaction. I grew up in Georgia. It's the same kind of reaction they had to black manhood. Black manhood. All over the world, all over the South. So it's been everywhere in this country. So my book attempts to show not only what they did, but how he responded to this. And that's why I said cool, because the notion of coolness comes out of the African culture. There's a word, olododo, comes from the Yoruba, and it means coolness. It's one of the things that you see. You know, when all the stuff is going around, you're cool. He exhibits that in a way that is profoundly African. And I like that quality about President Barack Obama. And as I've said over and over again, we have to understand America. I'm going to talk about that in a minute. The second book is called African Traditions. That's another book, African American Traditions, I'm sorry. African American Traditions. And it's a book that I wrote actually with my cousin, William Spivey. We actually looked at various areas of African American society, and we wrote a book dealing with adventure, commerce, education, arts, culture, et cetera, et cetera. And that book is also, I also have copies of that book here, African American Traditions. And then a third book is called The African Pyramids of Knowledge. And this book is a very important book, I believe, for the African world. Because what I try to do in this book is to readjust the thinking that we have about how knowledge comes into being. It does not come to us from the Greeks. It comes to us from the Africans, from black people. We were the first people on the earth. The first people on the earth were Africans. That's a historical fact. It's a genetic fact. All humans on the face of the earth today can be traced to the continent of Africa. There is no other origin of humanity except that, that the African origin is central. And so when I wrote the book, The African Pyramids of Power, what I wanted to demonstrate in The African Pyramids of Power is that instead of looking at Homer and the Iliad and the Odyssey as central documents in the history of the world, we ought to look at the pyramids. Because the pyramids are 2,000 years before Homer wrote the Iliad. 2,000 years. So that's Africa. So if you want to look at anybody as the origin of knowledge in the world, you start with Imhotep. You don't start with Homer. You start, that's why I went to the school, the charter school here, Imhotep, called that name for a very specific reason. And the specific reason is that Imhotep was the first multidimensional genius in the history of the world. He was a black man. So teach your children, start from this. This is the beginning. And don't be taken in by these contemporary movies that try to distort African history. The gods of Egypt. Now you know this was a joke. There are no gods of Egypt that were white anywhere. Nothing, no, never in the history of the ancient African world was this true. The mummy, and the mummy turns Imhotep into a bad character, an evil character. That you can't go by movies. You have to go by facts. That's important to us. And I say all of this because these three books, these are three of my 80 books, The African Pyramid of Knowledge, African American Traditions, and Lynching Barack Obama, How Whites Tried to String Up the President. Those are the three latest books. And I am now engaged in writing about five other books. I am trying very much. You know, I'll tell you what happened to me. When I was a student at UCLA, I went into the library one day. And I looked at the section where they had Africa and African people. And I saw so many negative books written about black people. I said to myself, we have to change this. White people are not going to change this. They're the ones who wrote all those negative things about it. You pick up book after book, and it's all negative about dark Africa, the dark continent, primitive people, savages, and so on. So we have to change that. So that meant that I gave myself a mission. And my mission was, in my lifetime, to do as much as I can to correct the narrative of African people. We have to reset that narrative. And we have to reset it for our children. Every day you try to reset that narrative. That's the only way that we can advance. If we don't do that, we'll finish. And we can do it. That's the beautiful thing about it. We have the history, we have the courage, we have the women and the men who have devoted their lives and dedicated their time to making a difference in the world. And this is the spirit out of which I come. Now let me just tell you what I'm working on now. I'm working on a couple of things. I'm working on Sudan. The issue of Sudan, and I'll tell you why in a minute. I'm also working on trying to help African Americans understand what's going on in the international realm regarding ISIS and the West. Those are two issues I'm working on. Now let me tell you why I'm working on the Sudan. I did my DNA test a few years ago, maybe 10 years ago, through AfricanAncestry.com. And it came back that on my father's side, the Y chromosome, my ancestors go back to Yoruba in Nigeria. But on my mother's side, the mitochondria DNA goes to Sudan, Nubia. So I decided that, well, I can't, first of all, I couldn't even imagine how someone could get from Sudan all the way across West Africa and then end up in America. But I began to be interested in what is this country, Sudan, about? And my interest in Sudan led me to talk to many people, the Beja, the Nubians, the people from Kordofan, the Dinka, the Nuwa, the Shalak, the people from Darfur, Blue Nile regions, all these people, the Nuba Mountains, to talk to these people and find out what's going on in Sudan. So I became deeply involved in the Sudan struggle. I went and spoke at the UN on Sudan twice. I've marched and demonstrated against the Sudanese government because of what is happening in Sudan. And let me just inform you about this, because the Sudanese tell me that the African Americans don't understand what's going on in Sudan, because if they did, they would be riled up. There would be so much anger, so many demonstrations against what's going on in Sudan. Sudan was the largest country in Africa in terms of territory. And then, of course, in 2011, it split so that you had the South Sudan is a separate country, because they fought for about 50 years for their independence from the government in the capital city, which is called Khartoum. And they won, and they're great heroes, John Garange. And John Garange have fought against the overlords in that country, and they cleared the country, and they made South Sudan. Now, South Sudan has its own problems now, but that's another question. But Sudan itself is a country of more than maybe 300 different ethnic groups. It's controlled, the government is controlled by a minority of people who call themselves Arabs. They're 15% of the country is Arab, 15%. Now, if I ask you what was the first African country to gain independence, you would say Ghana, 1957. Kwame Nkrumah, his favorite great statement, that Ghana's independence alone is nothing unless it's connected to the independence of the African continent. This was Kwame Nkrumah, great speech, and we say Ghana, the first African country that is independent, but that's not true. Sudan was independent in 1956, but because when it received its independence from the British, they declared, the people who got the independence were Arabs. They declared Sudan is an Arab country. It's not an African country. And that's why the rest of us said, Ghana then is an African country. Sudan is not. Sudan is 85 to 90% African. It is controlled by an Arab minority. You know what it's like? It's like South Africa was. This is what the Sudanese tell me. They said, y'all understand white racism, but you don't understand Arab racism. I'm telling you what the facts are. The foreign minister of Sudan, Ali Karti is his name. He and I had a big argument in the United Nations on this 2 years ago. There's this mystique in the African American community about Sudan that's false. And it's false, and not only is it false, it doesn't allow us to have any logical understanding or clarity about the issue, because the people who claim to be Arabs look like us. That's strange, isn't it? They look like an average African American. But they claim that they are Arabs because they trace their ancestry to Muhammad. And why do they claim that? Because when the Arabs invaded Sudan, they raped the black women and made a separate group that in the South Africa they call coloreds. In Sudan, they call Afro-Arabs. And those Afro-Arabs see themselves as better than the people who are genuinely African. Do y'all understand me so far? Am I making sense? All right, I want y'all to understand. We need to have this discussion. And Brother Paul Gibson, put this on the internet. It needs to be on the internet. Because we African Americans get confused. In fact, when I was at Temple University where I work, a gentleman who came to Penn came over to see me and was looking for a job and said he was from Sudan. I said, well, and he looked like an African American to me. He said, are you Arab? Are you African? He said, well, when I'm in Sudan, I'm Arab. When I'm in America, I'm African.
How convenient.
Didn't make any sense to me. But it makes sense in the context of Sudan. See, so what happens is that because many of our brothers and sisters are Muslims in this country, we get confused. And I said this some years ago in calling out Minister Farrakhan. See, Minister Farrakhan, you got to look at what's going on in Sudan. In Sudan, these people are killing black people every day. Mm-hmm. Every day. You Google Sudan. And Google fighting in Sudan. And why are they killing them? Not because they're Muslim. The people in Darfur, you heard of Darfur? How many people heard of Darfur? Okay, good. Everybody heard of Darfur. Let me tell you about Darfur. Darfur is a Muslim area of Sudan. The people there are Muslim. The black people who live in Darfur region of Sudan, which is Darfur is as large as France, the country of France. Sudan is a huge country. Sudan is as large as the United States is east of the Mississippi. You take all the states east of the Mississippi, you have Sudan. That's the country. The Darfur region is as big as France. The black people of Darfur are Muslims. The Arabs and the government are attacking the people of Darfur. Why? Because they won't become Arabs. That's because they're Muslims, just like the people who are attacking them. They express the same religion, but the people in Darfur want to keep their African language. Mm-hmm. They love their mother's cooking. They speak the culture and they live the culture and the song and music and dance of their grandparents. They don't want to be Arabs, but they don't mind being Muslim. So they attack because they have not bowed to this notion that Arabs are superior to Africans. That's the reality. You need to know this. You can't walk around and assume that you know something that is when you realize that the people who are Nubians are being attacked by the Arabs. And you know what? The whole of northern Sudan. Now, I've been to Egypt 16 times, to the south of Egypt, right at the border of Sudan. I've never been into Sudan itself. But the Nubian people are being attacked. Their villages are being razed. They're building dams along the Nile River to force the Nubians out, to create space for Arabs coming from Syria and from other regions of Southwest Asia. That's what's happening right now as we are here in this wonderful gathering. That's the reality. Now, so if that's the reality, then we have to raise a question, and a young man has just written a book, Bo Gadeng, D-E-N-G. You'll get it on Amazon in a few weeks. Bo Gadeng just written a book, Arab Racism in Kush. But not only is he writing, the people in Nubia they're crying every day. You can look up Nubian protests. What are they protesting? These are riverine people. You know what? You live along the river? Riverine people. These are the Nubians. They live like the ancient Egyptians along the River Nile. But what the Arabs are doing to them now is taking them from the river and putting them in the desert. They're not desert people. These are not desert people. They're moving them 800 miles away from their homes. And they've already taken over many of the areas that ancient Nubia used to have. So eventually, you would say, well, where's the African civilization, African culture? They say, there's no African culture here. There's no African civilization here. You see, that is the thing. So that's an issue that I'm constantly in. Every day I have letters and emails from people all over the world, particularly people who understand this issue. And in fact, this morning I got one. We've been to the Congressional Black Caucus. They don't understand it at all. It is the most, and let me say this. Congresswoman Bass, whom I met, who is in charge, who works with Africa for the Congressional Black Caucus, does not understand this issue. And that's what saddens me, that African Americans, we have surface understandings of things. And when you have a surface understanding of things and you don't look for deeper meanings, you're always confused. It's a confusion. And with the Sudan issue, this is an African country, always was an African country until the Arab invasion. Now let me give you the other part of this history. I spoke a little bit about this last night at the Molefi Kete Asante Institute. You have to understand, I'm going to give you a chronology, and then I'm going to fill this chronology in, then we'll talk about something else, but I want you to be clear about this. There was a general, his name was L. Oz, E-L, capital A-S, L. Oz. He is an important general in the history of the Arab invasion of Africa, because in 636, he invaded Jerusalem, and he took over Jerusalem, which had been under the control at that time of the Romans. He took that over. And then in 639 AD, the African people in Egypt, who had been in Egypt, they had been in Egypt from time immemorial. The African people, that's Egypt is African, black people. Even you can still see them. I still receive letters from black people in Egypt right now. Brother, young brother Abdul Malik Muhammad writes me all the time, black Egyptian, right? From Egypt. But so you've got these. Right now, you got these black villages and cities in Egypt. You don't hear much about, much like the reservations of the Native Americans, you don't hear about, you don't see them, right? And same thing in Egypt, right? You got these, the original people. So they asked the Arab armies of Muhammad to come over and help throw off the Romans. And they came over, and they helped them throw off the Romans. And then they said, I don't like this place. And they stayed. General Allies. He built Cairo in 641. Cairo is not an ancient African city. It's a relatively modern African city in the long thousands of years of history of Africa, you see. It was built by General Allies, 641. He builds this city, 641, and then decides that he will try to invade Nubia to the south. And they go in 656, and they try to fight against the Nubians. They are repulsed from the Nubians. And then they have to sign a pact between Nubia, Sudan, and the Arabs of Egypt. And they signed this pact. And it was supposed to be a treaty. And for several hundred years, okay, you don't bother us, we don't bother you. But then they began to encroach on that region, on the Sudanese region. Now Sudan at this time was Christian. Most people don't realize that. That Sudan was a Christian nation. It had been a Christian nation, one of the first Christian nations. After, you remember there is this story of the eunuch in the Bible, the eunuch who was in the court of the Candace, right? You remember that story. And he was riding on his way from Jerusalem or somewhere and so on, and they converted him or he could, something like that. There's a story about the eunuch from Candace. Well, the Candace, this Ethiopia, where supposedly he's from, is really Nubia, because the Candaces were the queens of Nubia. There were 42 women who ruled in Nubia. More people ruled, more queens ruled in Nubia than in any other country in the world. More women ruled. No other country in the world. Actually, more women have ruled in Africa than anywhere else in the world. And so the Nubian queens were very powerful queens. And so eventually you have this Christian population in Sudan. And after this Christian population in Sudan had been there for hundreds of years, you then get more invasions from the north, from the Arabs. And let me tell you something. Pope Urban II, you should never forget this name. Pope Urban II was the guy who led and called for the first crusades. Now this is important because this is going to give you the whole context. I'm bringing you all the way up to the whole history of what's happening right now. That's what I'm doing. Because you need to understand, I always want my community to know what the facts are. So when people start talking about people beheading people, when we start talking about the brutality of ISIS, we must see what are the lines here. There's some important lines here. You can't miss these lines. If you miss them, you won't understand anything that's going on today. I'm telling you, you got to understand what's going on. We got to understand. Very important what's going on. What happened in 1095 was that Pope Urban II was very fearful that what would happen would be that the Arabs and Islam would come west and take over all of Turkey. It wasn't called Turkey at that time. Take over Anatolia. So he was really nervous. And the church, there were two parts to the church at that time. There was the Roman Catholics, this is Rome, and there was the Orthodox, which was the headquarters of the Orthodox Church was Constantinople. Constantinople was, the church there was larger than the Church of Rome. It was called the Hagia Sophia. That's the name of the big church. In Constantinople at that time. So what happened? They believed, they were fearful that they would be taken over. They would be taken over by the Arab Muslims coming from Jerusalem and from the east. And so they said, we need to get the rest of the Europeans, the Western Church, the Roman Church, involved in this. And they created the First Crusade. 1096. Called for it in 1095. 1096, 100,000 Europeans came together to move across Europe and into Asia to fight what they considered to be the people who had taken over Jerusalem. Now, let me explain something to you. You know, we all talk about jihads today. This was the first jihad. You know why it was a jihad? Because Pope Urban and the Catholics said, if you participate in this holy war, that's where the term came from. Holy war didn't come from the Arabs. The holy war came from the Christians. If you participate in the holy war, you will get indulgences. And the notion of indulgences was that you will then go to heaven. Once you get to Jerusalem, By fighting and doing this, you will have apotheosis. You will be saved. And so people gave up their families, their homes, everything to join the army of the Crusades. You know what the Crusades mean, right? It means you're fighting for the cross. And so every time you vowed that you will go on this crusade, they gave you a cloth cross to sew onto your uniform, your shirt. And so they went. And so anyway, I'm going to make this story short. It's a long story, but let me make it short. They went. There were several of these crusades by the Christians fighting against the Muslims. There were great battles, some with names like with generals on both sides, Saladin, many of them, great, great people fighting against each other. George and all the various struggles, all right? So in the end, let's put it this way, let's move quick. Africans were enslaved in Iraq in the 9th century AD. Now, the enslavement of Africans in Iraq led to a revolt by Africans that was called the Zanj, Z-A-N-J, you can look it up. The Zanj Rebellion. These are black people enslaved by Arabs who revolted in Baghdad to get their freedom. Now, 900 AD is a long time before 1441, when Europeans got involved in slave trade. Do y'all understand this? I just want us to be aware of, I mean, all of it is wrong, but I just want you to know that you can't go around thinking that Arabs somehow never got involved in slave trade. They were the first ones that enslaved Africans. So what happened is that ultimately the Turks, the Seljuk Turks, conquered most of the territory that we today call Southwest Asia, they call the Middle East. They conquered most of that territory and they created what was called the Ottoman Empire. The Ottoman Empire. You heard of the Ottoman Empire? Because I'm cutting out a lot of stuff, but I want to make you, want to bring you up today. So the Ottoman Empire started 1453. In 1453, what happened was that the Muslims took over the city of Constantinople, and they renamed it Istanbul. And they took over the church. The Hagia Sophia, the largest church in the world. They took it over because they had conquered basically the golden stone of Christianity, the Hagia Sophia. They took it over and they ruled from Istanbul and they created more power, consolidated their power, created the Ottoman Empire. The Ottoman Turks were in control of that whole territory all the way from Istanbul all the way to Jerusalem. In World War I, cutting out a lot of stuff, but I want you to understand it. World War I, when the Germans were fighting against the rest of the people, the Turks chose to fight on the side of the Germans. And the French and the British saw that as a betrayal. And so what they did, when they defeated the Turks, Germans, French, Russians defeated the Turks, the British went to the Russians and said to the Russians in 1916, they said to the Russians, look, you can have Istanbul, and you can have the control of the route between the Baltic and the Black Sea, I'm sorry, and the Mediterranean, that whole area. You can have control of that. But just give us control of all the other lands. Because the Russians thought that was a good deal. But the next year, the British betrayed the Russians and made a deal with the French. This was called, you can look it up, it's called the Sykes, S-Y-K-E-S, the Sykes-Picot, P-I-C-O-T, agreement. This Sykes-Picot agreement is directly related to today. You know, we always talk about 1884 and 1885, the Berlin Conference, because that's about Africa. That's correct. And we ought to talk about that, because they're the ones who divided Africa up among the Europeans. But they didn't just divide Africa up among the Europeans, they divided Southwest Asia up. And the Sykes-Picot Agreement, they decided, the French decided, they wanted a certain area, which they would call Syria. They said to the British, and you can have certain areas that was south of that. And then, you know, including Palestine. Then they said, we can divide up the rest of the country. We can take Persia, and we can give them a little bit more territory called Iran. Mm-hmm. We can do all, and they sat down, these French and British people sat down and drew a map. And carved up these territories, Afghanistan, Iran, they did all that. And then they sat back, said, we're in charge. And the whole thing is falling apart. Because the whole thing was not normal. And so they created these problems that they didn't anticipate. And they didn't anticipate Arab nationalism. So the Arabs began fighting. So when, after 9/11, and the creation of Al-Qaeda and ISIS, what happened is that we now are in a struggle that goes right back to the Crusades. And that struggle, that what we see with the Muslim, the Arab Muslims who are deeply dedicated to this notion of jihad, is the same we saw with the Europeans devoted to the notion of holy war. And both of them are wrong, if you ask me. And both make no sense. None of this makes any sense to me. You're like, who is a God that thinks that murdering people somehow gets you into heaven? That makes no sense. Whether it's Christian or whether it's Muslim, it makes no sense. And as an African, I stand always on African principles as much as possible. Because I believe firmly that our ancestors had worked out for thousands of years, they worked out human relationships. And the human relationships that they worked out and the way that they saw society was based on might. The notions of truth, righteousness, justice, order, balance, harmony, reciprocity. That's what the Africans came up with. We are the ones who gave the world these notions, these spiritual notions of healing. So when we come to the African American population and the African American continent, society, community, we have to look at all of our history and make some sense out of it based on that. My brothers and sisters, there's much more to say, and I'm not going to say it today because I can go on for hours, but let me just say this to you, that I don't think that there has ever been people who suffered so much as we have suffered. And our suffering is right now mostly psychological and mental. But we can heal that. We are the ones who can heal it. And you start by reading. That's how you start. It opens your mind. And you don't take anything You don't just listen to Asante or anybody taking anything. You read, you study. You listen to me to point you into a direction. But then you read and you study and you argue and you, and anything that doesn't feel right to you is probably not right. If someone is saying that African people had no system of education, it don't even feel right. African people didn't wear any clothes. That doesn't even feel right. You can't go by nothing like that. You can't have people put anything on you. The beauty of the African people, the strength, the courage, the genius, all this is all a historical fact. And so I always leave with you, stony the road we trod, bitter the chastening rod felt in the days when hope unborn had died. Yet with a steady beat, have not our weary feet come to the place for which our parents sighed. And we have come over a way that with tears have been watered. We've come treading our path through the blood of the slaughtered, out of the gloomy past, till now we stand at last where the white gleam of our bright star is cast. Thank you very much.